Good morning, everybody. At Kelson Church again. Here I am, preaching in shorts and slippers to many of you in your homes. Hopefully we will not have too much more of these lockdown restrictions. I have been asked to talk on forgiveness, more specifically, on why I should forgive someone who hurt me this morning. Let's pray. Dear Father in heaven, forgiveness is important to you and was demonstrated in Christ for us. You forgave us and have told us to forgive others. It wasn't an easy task and it still isn't. I think that we are mostly pretty good at making things even worse when we try to patch them up. Once again, we have to throw ourselves on your mercy. Help us, Lord, to understand and carry out our forgiveness responsibilities. Help us to absorb what you have to say to us today, that you may be glorified as we walk in your ways. In the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Right, let's get cracking then. If you are a human being and not an alien, recently arrived in a spaceship from Mars, at some time there would have been someone in your life who has hurt you, and hurt you deeply. It may be a person you have worked with who wronged you, a friend who betrayed you, a parent who abused you, or a mate who deserted you. Perhaps you have difficulty forgiving that person. After all, doesn't your offender deserve to pay for what he or she did? We have the greatest difficulty in extending forgiveness to those who have wronged us. Jesus sounds scary in instructing his disciples on how to pray. He says, "And forgive us our debts as we have forgiven our debtors." Moments later, in verses 14 and 15, he drops the bombshell. "For if you forgive other people when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their sins, your Father will not forgive your sins." Oh, that is so difficult. They hurt you. It must be remembered. It must be avenged. Justice must be done and seen to be done. Forgiveness is like letting go a snake when you are holding it by the tail. The choice benefits the snake, but it benefits you more. Look at the benefits of letting go. Reduced anxiety and depression, less stress, better sleep, and a longer life. Misunderstandings about forgiveness keep us prisoners of bitterness. Forgiveness has the purpose of freeing us to experience the life of joy that God has given us to live. I would like to deal with this subject by outlining five misunderstandings that we have about forgiveness that are common in the church. Here's misunderstanding number one. Your offender has to earn your forgiveness. What could a person do to restore a reputation ruined by slander? What restitution could someone offer for a marriage devastated by adultery or a child killed by a drunk driver? The fact is, there is very little someone else can do to earn your forgiveness. In a three-legged race, your leg is bound to the person you're running with. And you can go no further or faster than that guy is willing to run. Similarly, when you say, "I won't forgive until my offender asks for it or earns it or deserves it," you're emotionally binding yourself to the person who hurt you. As in a three-legged race, you can go no further or faster in your life than your emotional partner, The person who wronged you is willing to go. But when you forgive someone, you are unbinding yourself emotionally from your offender so that you can move on with the life God has planned for you. Misunderstanding number two. Forgiving requires surrendering your desire for justice. There's a difference between justice and vengeance. Vengeance is our desire to hurt somebody for hurting us. The Bible says, "Do not take revenge, my dear friends, but leave room for God's wrath. For it is written, 'It is mine to avenge, I will repay,' says the Lord." Paul gives us personal illustration of that in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 4, chapter 4, verse 14. "Alexander the metal worker did me a great deal of harm. The Lord will repay him for what he has done." When we forgive, we let go of vengeance and say, "God, I'm letting you deal with my offender." But we don't have to release our desire for justice. Justice is the payment that God or others requires of the offender. We desire justice because we are made in the image of God, who is just. Misunderstanding number three. Forgiveness means pretending the offense didn't happen. We do people a disservice when we say forgive and forget. Forgiveness is a spiritual action, while forgetting is a biological action. Ignoring the offense short-circuits the forgiveness process. To forgive someone, you must go through the proper steps. You acknowledge that somebody has wronged you, you calculate what your offender owes you, and then you choose to release your offender and the debt to God. You are acknowledging that all you ever had and belongs to God. Anything you are given or owed also belongs to Him. It doesn't make God your owner, it makes Him your Heavenly Father. He has promised to care for you, to protect you, and to grow you in Him. It is your business to trust Him to do that. No one has offended you as much as you, in your sin, have offended God. He has, at enormous cost, forgiven you. All He has asked you to do is to forgive others. And when you do that, you're not making their offense not to have happened, but you are making them not to matter. Mother Teresa wrote this, and it's just incredible. I love it. "People are often unreasonable and self-centered. Forgive them anyway. If you are kind, people may accuse you of ulterior motives. Be kind anyway. If you are honest, people may cheat you. Be honest anyway. If you find happiness, people may be jealous. Be happy anyway. The good you do today may be forgotten tomorrow. Do good anyway. Give the world the best you have, and it may never be enough. Give your best anyway. For you see, in the end, it is between you and God. It was never between you and them anyway." Forgive people, not because what they have or have not done. Forgive people because of what God has done in you. Misunderstanding number four. Forgiveness means staying together in a relationship, in the same workplace, in the same wherever with the offender. Matthew chapter 5, 38 to 42, we read, "You have heard that it was said, eye for eye and tooth for tooth. But I tell you, do not resist an evil person. If anyone slaps you on the right cheek, turn to him the other cheek also. And if anyone wants to sue you and take your shirt, hand over your coat as well. If anyone forces you to go 1 mile, go with them 2 miles. Give to the one who asks you, and do not turn away from the one who wants to borrow from you. Does that mean we're called to some sort of punch bag or doormat? This situation often occurs in the workplace and can be toxic. To a far worse degree, where escape is more complex, it is found in marriage. I'd like you to look closely at this passage that we can then see what J.E. Adams has to say in his book, Marriage, Divorce, and Remarriage. First Corinthians chapter 7, verses 12 to 15. To the rest I say this, I and not the Lord. If any brother has a wife who is not a believer and she is willing to live with him, he must not divorce her. And if a woman has a husband who is not a believer and he is willing to live with her, she must not divorce him. For the unbelieving husband has been sanctified through his wife, and the unbelieving wife has been sanctified through her believing husband. Otherwise, your children would be unclean. But as it is, they are holy. If the unbeliever leaves, let it be so. The brother or sister is not bound in such circumstances. God has called us to live in peace. The reason appended to the command is this: God has called us to live in peace, writes J.E. Adams in his book. And he goes on to say, this important consideration has been overlooked by a number of commentators. We must not do so because it reaches to the bottom of the problem that Paul has in view. God doesn't want any loose ends dangling about a Christian's marriage. He wants problems in marriage resolved. He wants peace. Either there is to be a marriage or there isn't. God will not settle for something in between. That simply will not do. The matter must be set to rest one way or the other so that there will be peace. Too often Christians, on bad advice, have settled for the in-between. Let me describe it. Believing wrongly that she must remain married to her unbelieving husband, no matter what, a Christian woman holds on even when her husband wants to end their marriage. He then may begin running around with other women, if he hasn't been doing so already, and at length may even desert her. Yet, urged on by bad counsel, she will not agree to divorce. He may stay away from home for 6 month periods at a time, occasionally showing up for a week or so. This upsets the kids and the life of the home. Hopes are aroused and shattered. His wife may get pregnant, and so it goes on and on. She's always hoping against hope, yet there is no evidence at all of a desire on his part to consent to a marriage. She may hang on for years, if not for life. I cannot recommend this book strongly enough. It has been of enormous help to many married couples. In life, we will experience people who take advantage of us for their own ends, sometimes knowingly and maliciously, at other times because they float through life in a haze of ignorance and stupidity. There's nothing wrong in walking away from that relationship and seeking another path. Fool me once, shame on you. Fool me twice, shame on me. I won't be caught. Misunderstanding number 5. Forgiveness is the same as reconciliation. Not so. You can forgive without being reconciled to your offender. Forgiveness depends only on you. You may forgive even though the other may not. You choose to forgive regardless of whether the person asks or deserves to be forgiven. In Luke chapter 23, we read this. When they came to the place called the Skull, they crucified him there along with the criminals, one on his right, the other on his left. Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And they divided up his clothes by casting lots. The people stood watching, and the rulers even sneered at him. They said, "He saved others. Let him save himself if he is God's Messiah, the chosen one." However, reconciliation depends on both you and the offender. You must seek it. Years ago, I learned from a colleague that we must confront or despise. In the Bible, it is necessary for both parties in a dispute. Matthew chapter 5, 23 to 24. Therefore, if you are offering your gift at the altar and there remember that your brother or sister has something against you, leave your gift there in front of the altar. First go and be reconciled to them. Then come and offer your gift. In this, the first case, someone has something against you. They feel that you have offended them. Whether you think they are right or not, you are obligated through this verse to go and settle matters, to work it out, and to correct any misunderstandings. The verse shows clearly that your relationship with God is affected by any inaction on your part. In Matthew chapter 18, we have the second passage. If your brother or sister sins against you, go and point out their fault, just between the two of you. If they listen to you, you have won them over. But if they will not listen, take one or two others along, so that every matter may be established by the testimony of two or three witnesses. If they still refuse to listen, tell it to the church. And if they refuse to listen, even to the church, treat them as you would a pagan or a tax collector. Here it is, you that has something against someone. You feel that they have offended against you. You are also obliged to seek to clear up matters on this side of the argument. Any conflict, therefore, requires both parties to work up on clearing it up. To be reconciled with you, the offender must demonstrate repentance, go through a process of rehabilitation, and rebuild trust. This is the reconciliation process. It does not always work out, but it does not mean that forgiveness cannot take place. As Christians, we are to forgive because God has forgiven us. You and I owe a debt of sin to God that is incalculable. If we die without paying our sin debt, then we will spend eternity separated from God. The Bible says the wages of sin is death. The most consequential choice you and I make in life is this: who is going to pay for my sin? We can keep trying to pay our debt and never do it. Or we can say by faith, "Jesus, I believe when you died, you paid the debt for me." You may want to take time to do that today. Three steps to reconciliation with God are found in praying this. Dear Lord, I am wrong. You are right. I cannot help myself. I turn in full trust to the only one who can help me, Jesus Christ. Only when we understand the magnitude of our sin against God and receive his unconditional forgiveness, we can truly forgive other people. As Paul said in Ephesians chapter 4, be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving each other, just as God in Christ also has forgiven you. Extending the forgiveness we have received from God to others is life's most important choice, a choice that results in true freedom. Dr. Lewis Smedes wrote, "When we forgive, we set the prisoner free, and the prisoner we set free is us." Thank you very much. God bless you.